Well, here we are, week two of New Realities. We're glad you joined us. We're glad that you're here. It's the fifth Sunday of Lent, and we are going to get back into the Lord's Prayer today.
Really glad that you joined us and are continuing to join us during this time in a very different way. As we said last week, we are all spread apart, but yet this allows us to, in a way, still be together.
Yeah, we're glad we're able to still produce these and get this out to you and have you worship with us again. A little bit of advice, when there's words up on the screen, sing along. Confess your sins with us. Use the Apostles' Creed. Pray the Lord's Prayer. We want this to be worship. Even though we're scattered, we want you to participate in worship. And I think it'll make the worship time more meaningful for you as well. Well, we're going to get started with our opening songs.
Hear the holy roar of God resound. Watching waters part before us now. Come and see what He has done for us. Tell the world of His great love. Our God is the God who saves. Our God is God who saves. Let God arise, let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. He reigns now and forever. And His enemies will run for sure. And the church will stand, she will endure. He holds the keys of life, our Lord. Death has no sting, the final word. Our God is the God who saves. Our God is the God who saves. Let God arise. Let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. He reigns now and forever. Let God arise. Let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. He reigns now and forever. God who saves. Our God is the God who saves. Our God is the God who saves. Our God is the God who saves. Sing it with me, will you? Our God is the God who saves. Our God is the God who saves. Our God is the God who saves. One more time. Our God is the God who saves. Let God arise. Let God arise. And our God reigns now and forever. He reigns now and forever. Let God arise. Let God arise. And now God reigns now and forever. He reigns now and forever. Mm-hmm.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me.
We start remembering God's love for us in our baptism when his name was placed upon us in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite you to join me in this confession of sin, a confession of weakness before God. I will read through all the words of this, and you're invited to join in the parts where the congregation would normally speak. John wrote in 1 John, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen." Almighty God, in his great mercy, has given his Son Jesus to die for us. And for his sake, he forgives us all our sin. I therefore announce the forgiveness of all our sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Join me in prayer, please. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise that you are a God who hears us when we cry to you. We are grateful for the opportunity to bring the people we love, the situations we're in, the country we live in, the world and its problems to you, and know that you are able and willing to handle them. So, Father, today we pray for folks who are dealing with cancer. We pray for Jan and Chris and Deanna, for Rachel and Dick and Bessie, for Betty and Kathleen and Robert, for Claudia and Marcia and Dennis, for Adelaide and Mike, for Tom and Dean and Matthew and Lauren, for Kiplin and Charlotte and John. To this list we add Marlene, who will have surgery on Wednesday. We ask for your grace and mercy to cover these folks. Where they are in need, come to them and provide for them exactly what they need. Where they are weak, give them strength. Where they are scared, give them courage. Where they are discouraged, give them hope. Father, we pray that you would heal them according to your will. Father, we pray for folks who have ongoing health issues. We pray for Sandy and David, for Brian and Jay, for Carol and Ellis and Abby. Continue to watch over these folks, supply them with what they need for today, heal them according to your will. Father, we pray for this coronavirus. We pray for the leaders of our country and our world. We pray for the president. We pray for our governor. We pray for mayors of the cities in which we live. We pray for those who are making decisions. Give them wisdom and courage. And Father, help people to follow the guidelines that are out there, that we would distance ourselves, that we would wash our hands, that we would be very cautious, because maybe we're not sick, but the people around us are vulnerable and we want to take care of them out of love for that. Be with those who have been impacted by the coronavirus, whether it's their health, their income, their family, all of those things. Watch over them. Give them grace and mercy and hope. Give us as a church wisdom as how best to help folks who are hurting right now. Father, we pray for Steve Bernier as his sister-in-law Carmen passed away this week from cancer. We pray that you would lead this family to an empty cross and an empty grave, that they would know that because of Jesus and his victory, that the death does not have to be the final word. Give Steve comfort in this as well. Point him to a resurrected Jesus. Father, we pray today for the people who live on our street, the people who are not going to school with us, the people who are not at our offices, but who still need to know how much they are loved by Jesus Christ. So, Father, here's what we pray, that even in the midst of this crisis, you would be forming and shaping us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be people of grace, that we would live lives of grace, that we would speak words of grace, that we would be crystal clear about who Jesus is and who he loves, that we would bring grace and good news and hope to the people around us. Father, please do not let us and the people around us feel isolated, but Father, use this moment that we might be clear about Jesus. Father, we've been praying this prayer for years here at Cross of Christ, that by the power of your Holy Spirit working in us, there would be more people in heaven on the last day because of what you're doing here at this time with us. Father, we pray that you would hear us and answer. Father, we are scattered all over. Christians are scattered all over in homes all over the world. But together we are united in the faith and in the blood of Jesus Christ. And we join together to pray now the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
We have a couple scripture readings to bring before you, to share with you today. We're going back to the Lord's Prayer. As we said, this first reading is from Galatians chapter 3. And in Galatians, Paul here is talking about the beautiful way that Jesus and the promises that God has fulfilled in him bring us together. Starting with verse 26, Paul writes, "So in Jesus Christ, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise."
Wow, that's an apt and fitting scripture for a bunch of people who are scattered.
That's right.
We are all one. We are united. Well, I'm going to read the gospel reading from Matthew chapter 6. Jesus is teaching here, and he says, "This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." This is the gospel of the Lord. We're going to continue with our next worship song.
Standing up.
Well, here we are, back again at the table here. We really enjoyed doing the message this way last week, and so we heard some good things about it too from you, and so we thought it feels a little more, or let me put it this way, a little less like a hostage situation where either Marty and I would be up here just staring at a camera talking, and so
I guess that's more our problem than their problem.
Yeah, but. that's right. So we are getting back to the Lord's Prayer. And we're going to ask your forgiveness that last week we took a detour and got out of forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And so we're just going to skip that one, but ask for your forgiveness. And then we're going to jump in again.
So today we're picking up with the petition after that. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. And I want to be clear off the start. I know if you're like me, a lot of us have been in our homes this whole week, and you might have other people in your homes that are wearing on your nerves because you're in your home with them all the time. So when we say deliver us from evil, we don't have specific people in your house or my house in mind.
This is not targeted.
No, this is not targeted. In fact, Paul wrote, our battle's not against flesh and blood. It's really against something much bigger than that. Yeah. But when we say this prayer, when we say, lead us not into temptation, I think it's important to say what we're not saying when we pray that prayer.
Yeah, it's important to understand God is not tempting us. He is not the one who's providing the temptation. We don't need a lot of help in that. We're tempted on our own. So we're not saying, God, stop tempting me. We are saying instead that give us, by the power of your Holy Spirit, through the death and resurrection of Jesus, the power to stay out of temptation, the power to resist temptation, and when we can't, the power to run to the cross.
So when we're praying this, we're really acknowledging this is just a part of our life. It's not necessarily that we're saying God's going to lead us into this or not lead us into it. We're really saying it as an acknowledgement of the reality that we face each and every day in this world.
Yeah, the reality of who we are by nature is sinful, and temptation is part of that. And so one of the things that's helpful, at least for me in thinking about this, is that in the midst of temptation or trial, any kind of testing, there are two things at play. There are two different outcomes hoped for. And so let's talk a minute about those. So the first one is what Satan hopes to accomplish when he puts temptation in front of us, and how he uses trials or temptations or whatever it is. And his goal is to draw us away from God, to make us fail in such ways that we would believe we could never, ever have a right relationship with God. He wants to do what John 10:10 says, which is he comes to steal and kill and destroy, and he wants to tear us down and draw us away from God. And so that's what Satan wants. That's what the devil wants in the midst of trials or temptations. And we're in the midst of a trial. So Marty, what do you think Satan is trying to do?
Well, I'd say there's a lot of different ways that this trial has certainly blown me around, and I think blown a lot of people around. And one of the ways is we're certainly tempted to selfishness as this is all happening around us let's say for good reason, because we're not sure where we're going to be able to get these things that we need that aren't available on the shelf. And so we're tempted to hoard, we're tempted to do things that are only looking out for ourselves and then lose sight of the people around us. And that also has a dividing effect on us as well.
Yeah, it does. It does. It's interesting, though. I have found that in the store, people are actually almost more polite than they were before.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know if that's true. But so he's tempting us to selfishness. He's certainly tempting us to fear. To fear in such a way that we are crippled or paralyzed, and that feeds our selfishness, or it feeds our isolation, or it feeds our panic in what we're doing. And so he's tempting us to give up to the fear, or give in to the fear that life is never going to be the same, or whatever it is. And so he's tempting us to turn from God in trust to fear and letting fear win.
Yeah, and that, as you're saying that, I was thinking this is really, the temptation is to think this present moment and this circumstance is all that there is. And we're in that 3 weeks now, so it feels, it's starting to feel like that.
Yeah,
like this
yeah.
is all that there is. We don't see an end in sight. And so fear can really bubble up in the midst of that. I'd say another way that we get tempted, or all time, but really especially right now, is to doubt where God is and what he's doing in the midst of this. I mean, there are some hard questions.
Yeah.
With a virus that's spanning the globe like this one is, about what's God doing?
I mean,
what's he thinking in all this happening?
Yeah, where is he? What is happening? And honestly, I don't have the exact answers to what he's doing, but I know where he is. He's in the Word of God. He's in the person next to me. He's in Christians around the globe who are stepping up and doing what they can to help people who are affected by this. He is in his body, the church. He is in worship. He is there. He has not left us. And that's one of the things Satan is tempting us to do here, I think. He's tempting us in the midst of this to believe wrong things about God. So one of those wrong things is that, well, this has got to be a punishment on the world for whatever. You pick the sin, or you pick the whatever you want. And that's not how God operates. That's the wrong thinking about who God is. God allows the world to spin and operate, and it's a sinful world and it's a broken world, but God is not sitting up in heaven watching over us and thinking, well, this, now I'm really going to zap them with this. That's wrong thinking about who God is. God is where he said he always would be. He is in his word. He is in the person of Jesus. That's what God is doing right now.
Well, how would you say we know that's wrong thinking? I mean, someone can say that, and yet it's still hard to get out of that thought process. So how do we know that God's not up there tit for tat? Like I read someone's Twitter post who had a religious mom, and her mom said, "This is God telling you that you shouldn't be going out as much as you're going out." And so then she apologized and said, "I'm sorry, everybody. The coronavirus is my fault because I've been going out too much.
Too much dating."
But how do we know that that's really not how God is?
Well, in the book of Romans, in chapter 5, I think, which we're going to talk about chapter 5 a little later, but in the book of Romans, Paul writes that he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. So the Father didn't spare his son, but gave him for us all. How will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? In other words, if God is so on our side that he would send his own son to die for us.
Mm-hmm.
That tells you the character of God. He is not trying to beat us down. He is trying to resurrect us. And so he is not up there keeping score. He's not up there keeping score.
All right. Well, so those are the ways Satan uses
temptation
and trials, is he's using it to draw us away from each other or against one another. Can use different things to do that. He can use our selfishness and use our fear. He's using it to get us to think wrong things, believe wrong things about God, and then those actions stem from those beliefs. So let's talk about how God is at work in the midst of temptation and trial.
Yeah, so God doesn't lead us to temptation. He doesn't do that, but what he does do is he uses the trials and temptations of life, and he uses them in the exact opposite way that Satan uses them. Mm-hmm. He uses them to draw us closer to him. He uses them to, and look, the old hymn that we sing at the 8:30 service is, "My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. When every earthly prop gives way, he then is all my hope and stay." That's what God is doing in this. He's drawing us to himself so that we would be standing on the solid ground of who Jesus is. Hmm. James puts it this way. James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Consider it pure joy, brothers and sisters. That's a tough one. We can't tackle that today, but consider it pure joy, brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So in this time of trial, God is drawing us into Himself so that we would grow up into Jesus, who is our head, and that we would not lack anything, that we would grow in our faith. That's the goal.
So God is doing this to, I guess in a way, build things in us that, need to be built, or that will produce, as James says, perseverance in us.
Right.
And it's kind of unfortunate, though, that perseverance comes through being tested in trials.
Right.
But that's how it grows.
That's how faith grows. It's like it's a terrible analogy, but it's like a muscle.
Yeah.
It as it gets exercised, it grows. And so God is not doing this to us. He is using this to form and shape in us and draw us closer to Himself. So what do you think, in what ways is God trying to draw us to Himself? How's he strengthening our faith?
Well, I'd say it's a need that I have to know that I can trust Him with the things in my day-to-day life. Mm-hmm. And there has been so many new ways during this time of the pandemic that I've had to learn to trust Him in new ways and for new things that I really didn't have to lean upon Him before. All the new decisions that we've had to make, and just in our family or just at church, and reprogramming things and doing things differently, you just don't know how things are going to go.
Right.
And so I have to lean into Him as we're making those decisions, not really knowing the future and how things are going to play out, but trusting that the next day when I wake up and do the things that I'm making these decisions for today, that He's going to meet me there with grace, regardless of how well my decisions turn out.
Right. And I think the way He's working in my life is that there are literally moments in my day and in my week when I feel absolutely powerless to do anything that is going to be helpful. And I think He's forcing me to understand that there is a power I need, and it's Him.
Yeah.
It's Him. You know, Paul writes about this in Romans 5, which I mentioned earlier, and I'm just going to read Romans 5, 1-5. Therefore, he's just finished in chapter 4 talking about how we have been saved in the blood of Jesus. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into His grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So there's a lot in there. That's a whole another sermon we can't deal with. But let's just say it this way. God is working in us through trials and temptations, through suffering, with a goal in mind. And the goal in mind is hope. Hope in Him. And so we get to the word perseverance again. And perseverance, really all it means is sticking to it long enough to get the benefit that God is forming in you. That's what He's trying to do. And saying, not throwing up our hands, not running from God, not giving up, but it's to lean in further and further in the midst of suffering, to lean in further to a God who loves us. And so that's perseverance. And then perseverance produces character. Well, character, all it means in this setting is character is you become the kind of person who hopes in the midst of trials, in the midst of suffering. You do not let that suffering reshape your faith in any negative way. The temptation to believe wrong things about God, those things we already talked about. And so character then leads to hope. And hope is such a funny thing. It's an odd thing. Mm-hmm. You don't need hope when everything's great. You've got what you were hoping for. Mm-hmm. You need hope when things start to fall away from you and things do not turn out the way you want them to be. And so, so hope is uniquely given to Christians for a time like this, mm-hmm. that we would have something that pulls us forward out of this suffering to a better goal. Mm-hmm. Marty and I were just talking about this before the service, and we're saying it's a fine line to talk about suffering and hope because, honestly, our circumstances may not improve. In that fact, they may get worse. They may get worse.
Yeah, and I think, too, it depends where you're at because where you're at with the suffering and where you're at with is what's happening to you. I think this is a helpful explanation for me to know that God is, the Bible uses this analogy of a metal and the impurities being burned away in it. And yet, that cannot be helpful as well. Yeah. I think it depends where someone's at with it, yeah. where if someone's just really at the bottom of despair and suffering, it's not going to help to say, well, God's building character in you through this.
Right.
So I think, does that maybe help with that fine line that you're talking about, that balance is understanding where people are at in their suffering?
Yeah, I wouldn't say this is necessarily a counseling strategy. I would say that this is a faith-developing strategy. And oftentimes, this is why for parents, it's important to build this strategy in before your kids run into trouble. It's important for you to have mm-hmm. this built into you so that when trouble comes, when trial comes, when suffering comes, that there is some basis by which they can process and understand and look maturely to the fact that there is a goal, there is hope. Mm-hmm. But I think what we're trying to say is the hope is not in that the circumstances are going to get better. The hope is in God. The hope is in God. Mm-hmm. And that does not disappoint us. The circumstances may always disappoint us. I don't know. But God does not disappoint us. He has prepared for us. He has restored us. He has brought us to himself. And that will not disappoint us. Mm-hmm. And he gives us the guarantee. He says, because the Holy Spirit has been poured into you. Think baptism there. Mm-hmm. That the Holy Spirit has claimed you as his own. And you belong to him. And he takes you to Jesus.
And the beautiful thing about what Jesus has done is all of us are in this without any choice. Yeah. I mean, we are all suffering in many and various ways because of this pandemic, and yet Jesus chose to come in and suffer for us so that in our suffering we know we are not alone. And it doesn't mean that God has abandoned us and that Jesus would come and suffer for us in our place. It means all those things. And it's just a great source of hope for me, and I hope it is for you as well as we walk through this time. That's how great his love is, that he chose to come and do this, even though he did not have to do that for us.
Right, right. Well, let's move on to the next petition for just a few minutes here. Which is deliver us from evil. Anytime we pray this, folks, it is a like Marty said earlier, when we pray about temptation, it is an acknowledgement of the reality, okay? Anytime we pray deliver us from evil or the evil one, we are saying we need a deliverer. We cannot do it ourselves. That's what this prayer is saying. I need you to deliver me from the evil of this world, from the evil of myself, to a home that has been prepared for me by Jesus. I need to be delivered.
And we have it.
We have it. We have it. And it's interesting, Marty just said this, our deliverance is always through suffering. It's always through suffering. Through the suffering and death of Jesus Christ. That's how we are delivered. And he will deliver us. That is a fact. It is a truth. It is a hope that we have in Christ. Hmm.
So talk concretely about what are the ways that this petition is true in our lives through Jesus. How does deliver us from evil? What are the ways that he's doing that?
Well, let me start real personally. We're kind of in the book of Romans today, so let me stay in the book of Romans. Paul writes in chapter 7 of the book of Romans, and he writes it about himself, but man, he could be writing it about me. And he says, the good I want to do, I do not do, but the evil I don't want to do, I end up doing. And he gets this whole thing going about what is going to happen to him. And he says, what a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? I don't know how it works with you, but in my life, it is a constant need to be rescued and delivered from my own sin and my own struggles with who I am and how I define myself and all of that. And so Paul says, look, what a wretched man I am. Who will deliver me? And then he answers it with, thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So he doesn't just rescue me from circumstances. He rescues me from myself. He delivers me from myself, which is maybe harder to do than to rescue me from circumstances.
Because you've been trying for a few years and you haven't figured out how to do it. Yeah, me too.
I have, yeah. But we also have the confidence that even though our circumstances may not change the way we want them to or may last longer than we want or whatever, that ultimately, we will be delivered to a place where there is no more crying, no more tears, no more mourning, no more grief, no more disease. And we will ultimately be delivered. Yeah. So here's what we are praying for. We're praying that this brought you some hope, that as you see Jesus Christ and his death and resurrection for you, you know that hope will not disappoint you. Jesus will not disappoint you.
Yeah. So when we are praying, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, we are saying a prayer for hope. That God, in the midst of the temptations I'm facing, in the midst of the evil in me and around me, give me hope in Jesus in the midst of that. That's what we're praying for. We need hope, and God knew that, so he gave us this prayer to put it on our lips.
Yep, and I would say that if you're struggling to find ways to pray, you don't know what to pray about, pray this prayer. Pray this prayer. That's nothing wrong with praying a prayer that somebody else wrote, especially Jesus, by the way. That's probably a good place to start. Yeah, but pray this prayer because in it you are already praying that God's will would be done, that you would be rescued, that you would have what you need for the day, for your life, for all those things. Pray this prayer because it's a prayer of great hope for you and me. Well, we are going to continue with our next song, and we are hopeful that this was helpful. Oh. He's right. We're not going to continue with the song. We're going to continue with the creed. So I invite you to follow along with me as I read the creed. Join me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May he look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Now, we're going to do our next song.
Let's do it.
And pray, find in me thy all in all. Jesus paid it all. him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed in a white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed in white as snow. The throne I stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin
crimson.
crimson stain, He washed it white as snow.
Wow, that's quite a song. We're grateful for the fact that Jesus paid it all.
Amen. And
yeah.
For our band.
Our band, yeah. It's really great to have them here. Go ahead and applaud if you want.
They can hear it.
Yeah. Just a few announcements we want to share with you. If we are sending out an email every day with some scripture and devotion on it. If you're not getting that, email me or Kathy Flathammer at the front desk, and we'll make sure you get it. If you're not getting it, will you do me a favor? Will you look in your junk mail folder? We won't take it personally if it's in there, but sometimes that happens. So would you look in there and see if it's in there?
Another way to stay connected is through our podcast, and I was going to say if there's another name for that, maybe subscribing to that. That's the word. That's the word that I'm looking for. So there's a lot of other resources on there. We have worship on there and messages on there, but we also have some podcasts about how to read the Bible. And in this time when we're not able to get together as usual, some of those resources could be particularly helpful.
And you can get to that by going to our website. You can click on resources and just, it's right there. It says podcast. You can listen to it in your web browser just on your computer, or you can download the app from your app store and then subscribe to it, and they'll send you the podcast every Wednesday.
Then also other updates and things that we have will come through email, as Kevin said, or you can be looking for those on our website, and we'll continue to be posting worship there as well. Yeah.
And then finally, in this time, we want to be able to be there for each other, even if it's difficult. So if you have any needs, you know someone with any needs, we'd love to hear and find ways to help, if that's doctor's appointments or picking up medication or grocery shopping or whatever it is. We'd love to help. We have people who want to help with that. So if we can help in any way, let us know.
Yeah, please do.
Have a great week. Know we're praying for you. God bless.
Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed.